This podcast is a member of the Place to Be Nation family. Visit us at placetobenation.com, the only place to be in your pop culture world.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, it's time to grab your popcorn and your drink. Please take your seat and always silence your cell phones. The next showing of Place to Be Nation's Laughing Theater with Andy Atherton is about to begin.
Place to Be Nation, welcome back to the theater, the Laughing Theater, if you will, here on the Place to Be Nation pop feed. I am your host, Andy Atherton, and thank you for joining me tonight. Tonight, I've got a great movie lined up and a great guest, and let's not waste any time. He's very familiar around these parts of Place to Be Nation, Mr. Tim Capel. Tim, how are you tonight, sir?
Double A, I am great. I am especially great to be podcasting with you solo.
Yes.
I usually have company on your shows, but this is our first one-on-one podcast.
Yes.
And that's pretty awesome.
It is pretty cool, and I'm thanking you for joining me tonight. You've been on Great Debate. Have you been on Looking Forward, Looking Back? I don't know if you have.
I don't believe I've been on a Looking Forward, Looking Back.
So, and eventually we'll get you on Year in Pop once we get into like decades that, you know, years that most of Place to Be Nation
that,
was
that
actually
I was alive for.
No, yeah, was alive for. Right now we're going with the only four guys that were alive in the 70s. But,
work with what you have.
Yes, we do. People like to call it the old cast, if you will, which we're okay with. The motto gets a little wrinkle sometimes. He gets into that, get off my lawn, you snotty kids, but, you know.
Oh, he's a sweetheart.
He is. Big shout out to Jad, if you will. That was one of my favorite episodes of one of your shows, which we're going to talk about right now, Talkin' Pop, that you host with Miss Jennifer Smith. Tell everybody, if they haven't listened to the great Talkin' Pop yet, let everybody know who's listening to Laughing Theater what Talkin' Pop's about.
Well, Talkin' Pop you can sort of think of as like the talk show of Place to Be Nation. We typically have a guest on, someone that at least one of us knows from some walk of life, although a couple times I feel like we've had someone who was a little bit newer to both of us and has become a fast friend here on these interwebs. Although we also have just shows that are Jenny and I talking junk. Talking buckshit junk, she might say.
Fuckshit junk, I might say as well.
Yeah. Yeah. I can't say it as she would say it, but in any case, it's the show that I say it's whatever we want it to be. I hope you'll go in and at the end of it learn something or at the very least be entertained. But it's a very fun show to do. It's very loose. We really have no format sheet for that program. And pride ourselves on that. So we'll have to get you on it sometime.
Yeah, well, I'd love to join you guys. I like this. It's one of my favorite shows that I don't host, so.
Well, you do host a good number.
Yeah.
Of the shows that you don't host, there's not a lot, that's one.
I know, yeah. I love the Greg Phillips one was a great one. The most recent one with Glennie Butler. Was awesome. Glenn, who was on episode 2 of Laughing Theater, we watched History World Part 1. I suggest you listen to that if you haven't already. And whatchamacallit? And you guys also did My Father the Hero, great Gerard Depardieu vehicle.
we do live watches on occasion as well. Our most recent was the comedic classic, the romantic comedy of, what was it, 1993, 1994? Yeah. It's already escaped
me. A very young Katherine Heigl.
Very young, uncomfortably young Katherine Heigl and My Father the Hero with, again, as you pronounced it so eloquently, Gerard Depardieu. We did a live watch and commentary of that. We also did a live watch and commentary of Teen Witch from 1989. Yeah, that was our Halloween spectacular.
Wow. Yeah, I when I saw that go up, I was like, crap, I have to cross my Father Here off Laughing Theater's list. Damn it. You guys stole it. You guys stole it from me. I appreciate you guys falling on that sword, I tell you.
You know, that was my idea. I take all responsibility.
And none of the credit.
Funnily enough, that was one of two episodes that we've gotten zero feedback for, the other one being Teen Witch. So, you know, I think we're learning what puts the asses in the seats. That will probably impact.
That's all right. I keep checking the looking forward, looking back inbox, and there's nothing there yet for the summer movie wager. So we'll see. Maybe we'll get one. Besides those of us that will be on the show, which should be
we're in good company.
Yes, we are. Dozens are waiting to hear it. No, I'm kidding. No, we're you know what? We have a great nation out there. So, you know, even though sometimes they're silent, we know that they're supporting us. Yes. You are also one of the Sarcastic Four, with the manager, Todd Weber, with Mr. Mm-hmm. Nick Duke, and I want to say Mr.
Sellers.
What was that? Russell Sellers, that's right.
Yeah, I will actually have to give him a shout out in this episode when we get there. But yeah, the four of us, we are the hosts of Marvel Age, which looks at all of the great and not so great comics and full stories from Marvel Comics beginning in 1961/62 all the way up until we say the present. We'll see how long we do it, but each episode is devoted to, I won't say an entire year because we're doing half years, and we've been doing half years since about the mid 60s of Marvel Comics publishing schedule, just because there's so much to cover. And I think as we continue doing this show, you will see those years become more and more divided. I think we have like about a 10-part year coming up in the 90s.
Oh, God.
Yeah, so we're going to be spending a lot of time with some of these years coming up here on Marvel Age. So get comfortable, but it's a show that I have a lot of fun doing. Have a lot of just great cohorts there. I mean, these are guys I've known forever, have loved forever, and I know love these comics as much as I do. We've sort of been remixing our reading list, what we're going in, you know, to cover. But I say we, but it's really I who took umbrage with what we started with, which was basically somebody else's reading list that we'd been complaining about a little bit. And I don't know, I just got tired of the bitching and thought, hey, if we can do it better, then let's take a crack at it. And so I took a crack at it, and we'll see how we see how we do here.
Actually, yeah,
it could prove to be a disaster, but we will find out.
Yeah, everybody should give that a shot. I was joking on the last episode of Laughing Theater with the manager, Todd Weber. We watched Swingers, and I joked around saying, like, I don't know comics to the point where you could do a show called, like, we have Jeff Learns Wrestling. It could be Andy Learns Comics. You know, we went through my very small comic book collection. I mentioned I have, I don't think I have any more than this. I own 12 comic books as far as I know. Mm. And they all have to do with G.I. Joe or Transformers.
Now, well, that's there's a lot to be said for that, actually. Mm-hmm. Those licensed properties, those comics that Marvel produced both those series, if they are the ones I'm thinking of, kind of buoyed them in some lean years. So
yeah, it was
thank you for doing your part, Andy.
Yeah, it was the order of battle for G.I. Joe. Basically, it was like basically each character's bio on a page. Then there was Transformers Universe, which was the same thing but Transformers. And then there was the great four-part G.I. Joe versus Transformers, where Bumblebee, I think, gets blown up on the cover of the first or second issue.
Oh, good stuff.
Yeah.
I don't know if we'll be covering those, but I don't know. Stick tuned. We've got a lot of ground to cover on Marvel Age.
And then over on the wrestling feed, your newest show, Talking WCW, with your Talking Pop co-host, Jennifer Smith, and one half of the HTF, the Harsh Holly Fanboys, Mr. Greg Phillips. So what's going on over there in WCW world?
Yeah, so Talking WCW, it is our newest show, Jenny and I. Mm-hmm. It is a spinoff of Talking Pop. We talk wrestling on occasion on Talking Pop, but it's not really meant to be a wrestling show, you know? It's like, we feel like that's the Place Be Nation wrestling feeds jurisdiction. So we thought if we're interested in this stuff and we want to talk about it, we should just do a separate show. And we both love WCW mm-hmm. and different and sometimes intersecting ways. And it was kind of like, you know, the two of us, I think people already get a flavor for what a Tim Capel, Jennifer Smith show is like. So wanted to bring in a third man. Yeah. Had to get that third man in the booth. Greg Phillips was the first person we thought of. He actually said yes. We both thought he would say no. It was one of those like, oh, let's ask him, but have like, three other people on backup. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like just on standby because Greg's going to turn us down because he's just too good for this kind of thing. But to our amazement, he did say yes. And I mean, I just feel like everything's better with Greg Phillips.
Yeah.
So mm-hmm.
I had him and Nick on a big looking forward, looking back with Jennifer. It was a lot of fun. It was a long show. I apologize profusely for the length of the show the next day, but
never apologize for length.
They were great. I mean, yeah, we're not talking about like, you know, Zellner length, but we're sometimes we get a little long in the tooth. So let's start moving into why we're here though. So Tim, yeah. Would you like to tell everybody what we're watching tonight here in the theater?
Well, we are going to be watching Ghostbusters.
Yes.
This is the original Ghostbusters from 1984.
Yes.
And this is Laugh-In Theater, right? So we're supposed to be talking comedies mm-hmm. on this show.
Yep.
And I do absolutely consider Ghostbusters a comedy, as I think most people would. But, I mean, it has a lot of crossover appeal. It's got fantasy and science fiction elements, even horror elements, too, as we'll see.
Oh, yeah.
But first and foremost, I do think it's a comedy. It is not only my... Do I call it my favorite comedy? I might, but in a lot of ways, it's sort of just my favorite movie, which yeah. is a little bit crazy to say because this is the first time I'm talking about probably a non-comic book-based film on any podcast ever. So that'll be a little bit different for me. But I shit you not, Andy, I swear I've seen this movie – in excess of 100 times.
Yeah, I'm close to that, I think.
You know, and it's one of those movies that you can just keep coming back to. It mm-hmm. just doesn't really quit. And I want to say between the ages of about 5 and 7, I watched it in some form or fashion pretty much every day of my life.
Wow.
Yeah.
So, is that how
living with my grandparents, it was one of those, like, they recorded it on VHS, mm-hmm. you know, off HBO. So it was just this tape that I just wore out over and over and over.
Yeah.
And I still have that tape. I shudder to think what would happen if I popped it in a VCR today.
If you have one nearby, handy one.
Yeah, if you have access to one, right? But, I mean, that's just, it's, you know, that childhood nostalgia, but it's also, you know, it's stayed with me over the years because there are so many jokes and just so many scenes that go over your head as a kid that you appreciate as you get older.
Yeah, so many lines to quote.
Right. I mean, it's so quotable. So very quotable. Mm-hmm. I love it top to bottom. You know, there's a criticism that it hasn't necessarily aged well. I think we can get into that as we go mm-hmm. and maybe break that down a little bit. But to me, it's just kind of timeless, and I don't know that, you know, people who have never seen it, seeing it for the first time today could say that, but I don't know. Maybe we can get your take on that.
Yeah, it's something we grew up with. I mean, I'm a little older than you, so mm-hmm. I was about 11 or 12 when this movie came out, and I did go see it in the theaters. So I remember seeing it. I remember this is when I first started swearing. Cause I remember my sister, my sister took me And I remember there's a scene at the end when I think Slimer flies at the thing. I think it was after the movie had ended. And he flies at the thing, and I just yell out in the theater, "Oh, shit!" And my sister looks at me like, "What is wrong with you?" Because she's about 4 years older than me. So it's like she was forced to take me to the movies in Yonkers, New York, actually. And
these are the kinds of memories that stand out. Yeah.
I remember having a Ghostbusters shirt, like a long sleeve light blue shirt that says,
you had the blue shirt. Yeah.
Back off, man. I'm a Ghostbuster or something like that.
I know exactly the shirt you're talking about.
You know, everybody.
I had one as a kid that I just completely liked the VHS tape, just totally wore out until it more or less disintegrated. So, I know exactly the shirt that you're talking about.
I think a friend of mine had the game for the Commodore 64 where you had to, like, yeah, it was a rough game. You know, yeah.
You remember the NES game?
I think I remember briefly, yeah.
That was pretty rough, too. A lot of climbing flights of stairs.
Yeah. Yes, yes.
You really felt for them.
Yes. How many more? I'm going to throw up, you know, kind of thing. A little trivia, though, that I found out a few years ago. I work on people I've talked about my job. I work in television. I've worked on biography before. And it was, I think, the Belushi bio, or there was a series that we had called The Last 20. It was called The Final 24. And it basically chronicled the last 24 hours of somebody's life. And they did a Belushi episode. Mm-hmm. And the night that John, I guess he OD'd or whatever happened, Ackroyd was actually writing Ghostbusters that night, he says, in an interview. And he was writing it for John. So I would think John was probably the original choice for Peter Venkman, I'm guessing.
Yeah, that's what I've heard from all the original concepts that were, you know, built into the movie as it ultimately would come about. It was Dan Ackroyd with this great fascination with the paranormal that he had, and he just had this grand vision for something that was going to be like time and space spanning, where he and John Belushi, as you said, were going to be these sort of interstellar paranormal policemen, essentially.
Kind of like Men in Black meets Ghostbusters, it sounds like.
Yeah, a little bit. Yeah, like what Men in Black would sort of become many, many years later. And, you know, at the time, of course, this is deemed completely unfilmable because the budget required is just not something that exists in the early 1980s. Mm-hmm. So they pared that down, and what we got was a much, much more grounded film, I think, to its credit, certainly. And, you know, Belushi is out by then. He had unfortunately died some years before the film was released. Bill Murray comes into the picture. You know, I also heard that there were talks of putting Eddie Murphy and Richard Pryor into the picture. And it just kind of sounds like the character of Peter Venkman kind of got split into what Bill Murray and Ernie Hudson would ultimately play.
Yeah.
You know, it's kind of a working class, but still pseudo intellectual scientist. Mm-hmm. And, you know, these are things we can get into, certainly.
All right. One last thing, and then we'll start the movie. I promise, listeners. There's sort of a universe, I guess, if you will, that are connected, non-connected. Now, there was Ghostbusters 2. Which I don't know if I'll have it on Laugh in Theater. I'm not the biggest fan. I think there are some. I think Peter McNichol is hysterical in the movie.
I can think of someone who might, if he is chosen as a guest, might like to do that.
Okay. What are your feelings on Ghostbusters 2?
Ghostbusters 2, it sort of feels like a sequel that is cut from that 80s mold of doing sequels, where it's like it doesn't have grand visions of really moving the franchise forward in some huge way. Like, we think of these big franchise productions now as, number one, they either have eyes on doing a trilogy, right? And the second installment of any trilogy is always, well, it's The Empire Strikes Back of whatever it is. I mean, that's what you hear constantly. Or it's just going to be this, you know, forever type of installment.
Or Caddyshack 2. Oh, God. the other end of the spectrum. You got Empire Strikes Back.
The other end of the spectrum, yeah. Total turd, I guess you could have. But, I mean, you also have, like, things like the James Bond franchise and certainly the Marvel Cinematic Universe, where these concepts of finality don't really exist. It's just sort of – it keeps going, keeps going, keeps going. But, you know, in the 80s when they did a sequel, I think it was Mel Brooks who said, give them more of the same, essentially, or give them the same but better, you know, where people knew what they signed up for. But it wasn't going to be anything radical, earth-shaking, going to reinvent the wheel. It was just another installment in the thing that you already knew about and liked. I mean, look at RoboCop 2. Mm-hmm. Look at, you know, Back to the Future Part 2. All fine movies, but they're not revolutionary by any means.
Yeah.
So I just think it's kind of similar to that, where sort of the definition of diminishing returns, where it's like, yeah, you can't really go home again. It's still the same ingredients that we had before, but it's just not the same. And I don't dislike it as a movie at all. But it's just sort of, you know, sometimes this stuff is like lightning in a bottle.
Yeah.
In a lot of ways, I think this original picture is that. So, yeah.
That's great.
I mean, It's all right for what it is.
Yeah, I had always hoped back then, actually. I'm like, they should, like, do, like, franchises, like Ghostbuster franchises. Like, I always wanted to see, like, John Candy, Danny DeVito. Like, you know, you think these guys are going to show up, these buff guys, and you see this huge guy, this little guy, all these different shaped Ghostbusters kind of thing. And then it kind of turned out, what's funny is that years later, I went to Orlando for spring break with some of my fraternity brothers. We went to Universal Studios, and the Ghostbusters attraction at the time was you were going there like you were going to a seminar to open up your own Ghostbusters franchise. And it was great. And then then you go into this one room and there's like the rooftop basically from the end of the movie. And it's a screen though, because, you know, then they do effects on there. The Stay Puft Marshmallow guy shows up. And a fun fact that I actually bought the video about Universal Studios Florida, and I'm watching it one day and I'm like, I recognize the Winston walk around character being played by the great Wayne Brady, once played Winston Zeddemore at Universal Studios Florida.
All right, I could kind of see it.
Yeah,
you know.
Yeah, we all got to get our start somewhere. So, what about the female version that kind of wasn't really connected? The Paul Feig vehicle from, I believe it was like 2016. I think it came out. I actually showed the original Ghostbusters to my daughter, who is turning 17 shortly, the night before we went to see it. And then after we saw both, I asked her what she would like better, and she actually said the female one. So, which I think is actually not a bad movie, but it's not. And it's funny, that movie, they do more ghost busting, really, than this movie. This is more ghost catching. But Ghost Catchers doesn't sound as cool as Ghostbusters.
Yeah, I mean, that is a fair point. They sort of do a little bit more with the concept when you think about it. I mean, it's kind of neither here nor there for me. I'm the type of person that for years and years and years, you heard about, let's face it, like the 800-pound gorilla in the room is the supposed Ghostbusters 3 conceptual sequel that Dan Ackroyd has been talking about forever and a day, that has just never gotten off the ground. And then that kind of gives way to, as you said, this Paul Feig vehicle, the all-females Ghostbusters that, you know, ruffled so many feathers. Like, I just don't have a dog in that fight. Like, I don't care. Like, I was never all that interested or invested in the idea of a third Ghostbusters movie anyway. Just for the reason I said before, it's kind of like lightning in a bottle. They did it a second time with all the same people, and it still wasn't as good, right? So now you're going to try to do the same thing. But it's going to be impossible to get all the same people because, well, one of them is now unfortunately deceased. And it's just sort of, how many years removed are we now? Almost 30 from the second movie?
88, 89, and,
I'm like, why? You know, it's kind of okay for things to end, right? Like, it's not everything has to have that kind of franchise opportunity. I mean, I know the studio always looks at this stuff and sees dollar signs. Any piece of hot IP, you know, that has value or had value at any point, they're going to look at it and say, let's milk that for all it's worth. And yeah, that's what you do. It's just, I don't know, creatively, I was like, I don't think there's a lot of juice in the tank for a third Ghostbusters in the first place. So if they're going to reboot it, okay, fine. The result of that was just sort of, I don't know. I just felt like it kind of proved my premise going in that it just didn't have a lot of legs.
So so you haven't seen the teaser that came out not long ago?
I have seen the teaser.
The Jason Reitman, I guess Jason Reitman is directing and taking over for his dad.
Son of Ivan, right?
Yes. Uh-huh. Well, I'm actually a big Jason Reitman fan.
I mean, he's done good stuff in his own right. Uh-huh. Yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah, they have that, you know, it's a kind of a, you start hearing the theme and you see the flashes and then there's a car under a tarp and you just see the license plate Ecto-1 and it's like, you know, we're going back. So with a younger crew, I guess. And I guess
I don't know. I mean, I don't know. To me, it just, yeah, it hits the right buttons. You know, it gets that very Pavlovian response out of you where you're like, oh shit, it's Ghostbusters. You know, but is it anything beyond that? Mm-hmm. And we haven't seen enough to say one way or another, but in my own sort of cynical mind, I'm like, I just sort of wish sometimes they would come out and say, yeah, this is a cynical cash grab. It's only valuable if you have a lot of nostalgia for the first Ghostbusters. We're going to make it a total nostalgia-filled, you know, fantasy, and come see it if you love the first Ghostbusters. If you haven't seen it, then probably don't waste your money. Of course, no one's going to say that, but I sometimes just kind of wish they would. So, I don't know, because you almost already know what it's going to be. You're going to show up and go, well, it wasn't the same as the original, but it made me feel pretty good inside. I got warm and fuzzies. It was like comfort food. And it's probably all we can really ask for of any continued Ghostbusters installment. So I don't know. We'll see. We'll see. Am I going to go see it in the theater? I don't know. Again, it's too soon to tell based on what we've seen so far. But I mean, I say that being who I thought was like the biggest Ghostbusters fan that I knew. And then I met Russell Sellers.
Ah.
And,
a future Laughing Theater guest.
Okay. So future Laughing Theater guest. Think about that, Russell. Think about your choices. I hope I do well by you, sir. I do bow to your superior fandom of Ghostbusters because, man, have you seen his proton pack and his like full on Ghostbusters cosplay?
No, I haven't. I think I saw his birthday cake though, in a picture, because his birthday was not that long ago, I believe. I was like, wow, he must love the Ghostbusters.
It is amazing. He's got it going, like all the Ghostbusters fan clubs and stuff, which
I've seen that.
You kind of alluded to. There's kind of different chapters around the country, I gather. And you know, I don't know that he participates in any of that, but from what I've seen, like the costume, the gear, so freaking professional looking. Like, I almost feel bad. I told him I kind of felt bad choosing this movie when you asked me to be on the show. Cause I was like, I know that is his favorite movie. And, I have to tip my hat to him hope that, we can do this movie justice.
I'm sure we will. We'll see. Maybe for his second, when I get to season two, maybe we'll do him and I will do Ghostbusters 2. How's that?
Yeah, keep it in mind.
All right. Yeah, I remember seeing that. My girlfriend and I, not this team has since moved. We had the Bridgeport Bluefish, minor league baseball team, unaffiliated, independent league. We went to a game in August, I guess 2017. We had been dating about 6 months, whatever. And there was the local Ghostbusters chapter, like, you know how, like, they have the stormtroopers have that, what is it, the 4077, I don't know, let's mash, whatever the hell it's called, the 891st or whatever.
Good enough.
Yeah.
Ladder company number 8.
Or yeah, whatever. It was like whatever it was. It was amazing how these guys were all in costume and during a minor league baseball game. It was great. Great to see. Mm. So, without further ado, though, we should start the movie, I guess. Yeah, that's why, kind of why we're here. As much as, you know, I love the banter with you, Tim, we got to get the movie going to have some better, more banter.
We should actually watch this.
All right, so
hopefully it's been valuable pre-show.
Yes, yes, we're giving the backstory.
great.
So we are paused, both of us, right now. We are at the Columbia Pictures logo. The words Columbia Pictures have just come up. There's a little bright, shiny light coming out of the torch of the statue of Lady, whatever she is. So we're going to count you
very
in.
Very hachi-machi Columbia Pictures.
Yes,
woman.
HMH, as you like to say.
As I like to say.
Yes. So here we go. We're going to count everybody down, and we're going to hit play. Ready? In 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, play. I'm hitting the buttons on my PlayStation. Come on. Okay, here we go.
Okay.
I'm not used to it. Actually, my MacBook is blocking my view to my controller's view to the PlayStation, so.
Oh, that's okay. I'm watching this on Media Player Classic, throwing it back 2003 here.
So we're panning down the New York Library. Let's make sure we're all now.
Yep.
Just saw a lion
coming
statue.
The lion, the iconic lion of the New York Library. Here we go. Yep.
Yep. The old lady. I've been to that library, actually.
Have you?
Well, I'm from the area, so I think I went in there just because it was in Ghostbusters.
Hard not to. Yeah. I always think of honestly, now I'm already taking it back to comics. There is a comics event, very briefly, in the 1980s called Inferno. It was an X-Men centric crossover, and it was basically like all of these inanimate objects in New York City becoming possessed by evil spirits and demons, including the lions in front of the New York Public Library.
Oh, that would be cool.
I fought Daredevil, I want to say. So look forward to it on Marvel. Age, I guess.
At some
That's
point.
Always what I think of with this movie and especially this setting.
So we're in the basement now. The lovely elderly, I don't know how elderly she is, but she's a little older lady and she's putting books away.
Sure.
And there's books floating by and something's not
total
right.
Total librarian.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. And then the eerie music, of course, too. Just we can't hear it right now doing this commentary, but I know you and I can both hear it. So spooky, so mood setting, and even over the Columbia Pictures logo, like I associate that with this movie, that logo, because I watched it so many times.
Yeah, well, it's kind of like the when you see a Star Wars movie and you see when Lucasfilm doesn't come up as the Fox thing is ending, it's not right.
No, it's not. You want to see Fox. You want to see the spotlights, what you think are lightsabers. Yeah. Here we go.
Here we go.
Money shot.
Yeah, she's getting scared, and here's our opening title with the great logo, Ghostbusters.
Mm. Yeah. Card catalog flying everywhere.
Yes.
Way back.
The Dewey Decimal System, which kids today will never know the joy or pain of learning.
Exactly. Well said.
Here we are in Weaver Hall.
That's right. We are in Columbia, the unnamed Columbia University, which was filmed on location on condition they could not call it Columbia University.
Now we have a paranormal, I guess, ability test or psychic ability test, and with the Dr. Venkman, played by the great Bill Murray,
and with a
geeky or dorky guy. And then you have a very pretty blonde who people may recognize as Gwendolyn Pierce from Charles in Charge.
Ah, very good. I would not have known that. So.
I had to actually work on that series for one of
Did
my
you?
Jobs. Yeah, well, I was reformatting it for Nick at Night years ago, but we skipped the Pembrokes. We went right to the other family. And now this guy keeps getting it right, and he's telling him it's wrong, and he's shocking this guy. I love that. The gum comes flying out of his mouth.
And he's awarding all of the answers to her, even though she's getting it wrong.
Yeah.
I mean, this is just such a Bill Murray role,
yes.
Right? Where he's like, he's a grifter. He's kind of an asshole, kind of unlikable, but so funny at the same time that you sort of can't help but root for him.
He's funny and charming. All in that.
That's not something everyone can pull off.
No. And then this guy
tells me he has 75 more to go.
Yeah.
And he actually, shocked him.
And he actually gets it right on the last try.
Yeah.
It's a couple of wavy lines. Why is my CC not on? What's going on here?
Well, the movie's so quotable, you almost don't need closed captions.
I know, but it kind of helps you, remind you, I guess, of that.
And this is like some, it's not the Stanford Prison Experiment, but there were studies like this where it was, the participants weren't actually shocking people, but they were told that they were. And it was sort of just kind of a test of people's sadism, with pretty dire results. So I guess this is maybe a play on that. I feel like that was done in the 70s or early 80s. This movie is 84, so I don't know.
Yeah.
Could just be a coincidence, you know, college studies being what they are.
And now here comes the ultimate cock block and Ray Stantz coming in. You know, he's making his time with a grad student, and this is it. This is it. We found something. And then
storm
slap.
I love the slap, the jump and the slap.
This is very Burt Reynolds, Dom DeLuise esque, if you will.
Yeah.
I'm in the middle of something, Ray. Now, who hasn't, like, you know, gritted their teeth to a buddy and like, all right, I'm in the middle of something. Get out of here.
Timing could not be worse.
Yes. I'm very excited. I'm pleased, but you need to go.
And Ray is just everything that Bill Murray his character represents is just what Ray Stantz is not. He's just all art, totally sincere, a complete nerd. Not the academic that perhaps Egon Spengler is, who we will meet in short order, but. I mean, you almost wonder, like, what is their history? You know, what's their origin story?
Mm-hmm. I don't know. Was that ever answered on the real Ghostbusters cartoon? I don't know.
Perhaps, yeah. I mean, this is a multimedia spanning property.
A cinematic universe, if you will.
it sort of is, yeah. Mm-hmm. Now, were you too old and too cool for the real Ghostbusters cartoon?
I watched it briefly. I don't remember. I watched cartoons all through college and everything. Like, you would literally come home and watch the Disney Afternoon in college.
Gotcha.
You know, we had help with that. So that's something that you talked about with Mr. Butler kind of things, that kind of aided in the enjoyment of said Disney Afternoon when you're a college student.
Yeah. I mean, there's not as much to watch, I guess, back then. And yeah, you might need a little help from your, medicinal friend.
Yes. But so they introduce Egon. This is Egon. You just tell this guy is just right. He's got a stethoscope up to a desk.
That's right.
Now you can't
hear. He is in his own headspace.
Yes. He's the one they don't like let out at parties. They keep him in the back and bring him out when he's dead. Now it's so funny.
That's right.
And this poor librarian, now she has such a New York accent. Here, because it's so, she's like, my uncle thought he was Saint Jerome. She sounds like a relative of mine, actually.
Amazing.
Yes. Alice, are you menstruating?
Yes. Bankman asking her a series of increasingly embarrassing questions, because he's just, this is BS, right? Like, there's no way this lady is just, she's lost it. She's had some kind of episode. This is nonsense.
I love his response, though, when the guy goes, what has to do with anything? Back off, man. I'm a scientist.
Exactly.
He couldn't be less interested in going into the basement right now.
No. With the total skeptic, total cynic.
Like, I think he's just in it for the chicks.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And then they find the stack of books.
Right. Which, again, symmetrical book stacking.
just like the Philadelphia mass turbulence of 1947. You're right. No human being would stack books like this. Yeah, and all these gadgets they have, like Egon's got this thing. It looks like somebody took like a Simon game and just added like, you know, edges to it from another 80s toy.
Now that you mention it, it's sort of Star Trek, but not quite. Yeah. That being the it's called the PKE meter, or at least an early version of it, I guess.
And Venkman now, he always gets the kind of the shit jobs though. Sometimes.
Yeah, it's the butt monkey here in the group having to collect someone's phlegm, as he believes.
He's like, somebody blows their nose and you want to save it. He gets in his eye.
Just wiping it all the bullets. God, what an asshole.
Then he gets on his shoes. He's just like, what the hell? Egon, your mucus. Very.
And it's like, this reminds you of basically every library you've ever been in.
Yes.
You know, it's I don't know if that's an experience that people really even still have today, but no. Like growing up, having to do actual.
Yeah, work in a library.
Reports and research projects and or even working in a library. This is just so recognizable.
The meter kind of perked up. Very, you notice how 80s the hair is too on these guys.
Oh my God. Love it.
Oh, they see the ghost. First ghost we've seen. We see a little.
A full torso.
Yeah. And I guess she's giving off a breeze because their hair is starting to move a little bit. And there's Pete Venkman going, so what do we do now? And there, the other two guys are like, we didn't get that far yet. Can you come here for a second, please? Come here, Francine. He pulls him by his ear, which my mother did that to me quite a bit in the 80s, too. It must have been an 80s thing.
Amazing.
Good idea.
This is a ghost chilling, reading a book.
Of course, the one guy that doesn't want to be there has to be the one that has to talk to it.
Of course. Hello.
Where are you
Why
from?
Do ghosts wear clothes is my question.
I don't know.
That's my skeptical, cynical question, my Peter Venkman question. Why would they wear – why do their clothes die with them? I mean
– oh, yeah, that's true. I mean, you're anyway. – I don't know. Maybe that's not just in the cards when you become a ghost.
It's just not in the cards.
Maybe that's just like, you know, not – got to read the fine print, I guess. I don't know. Mm-hmm. And, of course, they go to try to catch a ghost. It's a little scary for a kid, and they just start hauling ass outside the library. Yeah.
I will say that was one of two scenes that freaked me out in this movie as a kid.
Yeah.
Where I was like, I either would leave the room. Usually I would just leave the room during this scene because it's very quick. But there's another scene coming up where I would actually make my grandmother fast forward through it. So you can perhaps guess what that is.
Yeah.
But we'll see if I flee the room and flee the podcast, about 45 minutes from now.
Ah. So now they're like thinking about the possibilities of what this is. Mm-hmm.
I mean, they just had this incredible experience.
Yeah. And he's kind of like, now it's kind of like wheel spinning in his head, like money.
Mm-hmm. Yep. How can I get money in Shakespeare?
Anyway, I love how he goes, are you serious? I'm always serious. And he offers him, what kind of candy bar is that? I always
what is, yeah.
I can never, because they never zoom in on it. It's not, it's a red, white, and blue kind of thing, but it's not, you don't zoom in. So yeah, now they're, come back to their office and it's basically all their shit's getting taken.
This is kind of an underrated funny scene. Yeah. Just, this is preposterous. I demand an explanation.
Fine. This universe will never.
Just trying to turn it back on, you know, when he's, you know,
when he
having
needs
to defend himself here. Yeah.
And here's the Justin Rosero with the Jets hat on and the headphones going, listening to music.
Move their shit out.
And Justin would be just like, fuck you. I'm here to do a job. Get out of my way. And he just calls him out now for being a bad scientist. And he like kind of, you see the look on his face like, yeah,
I see.
He just says, I see. Because he knows he's full of shit. He just hopes nobody else does.
Just an amazing response. I'm going to use that from now on in my everyday life. Just, I see. Covers all the bases.
You know how much money he made as a patent clerk?
Right. Oh, Ray's got a great line coming. Oh, he just said it. Yeah. I've worked in the private sector. They expect results.
I mean, now who among us hasn't drank whatever? It looks like they're drinking brandy on the.
Yeah, I've always wondered. Like, it could be schnapps, maybe.
Yeah.
But maybe brandy. Yeah. I've always kind of enjoyed this scene, too. Just, what do? You've gotten evicted from your cushy public university position. I gather they did not have tenure
because
they got thrown out on their asses pretty much in the course of an afternoon. Don't know what they're going to do now. And so Ray takes out a second mortgage, I guess.
I think he says everybody has three mortgages nowadays.
Okay.
19%. And then Egon with his mini calculator there.
Yes, Egon has done the math.
$95,000 interest in the first 5 years.
Right. Everyone has three mortgages, Ray. Just
franchise rights alone. Like we said, they should have franchised. Now they find the iconic firehouse here.
Go ahead. Yeah.
And this woman, the realtor, she was a character actress in the 80s. She appeared a... always like the funny neighbor, the realtor, the mother-in-law.
She's one of those, oh yeah, her, mm-hmm. Yeah.
And of course, Egon basically shits on the whole place.
The neighborhood is a demilitarized.
And then there's Ray, whose money it is. Does this pole work? Can we slide down like a fireman?
So exuberant.
Yeah, he's the child of the group. You gotta try this pole. Come on, can we have a sleepover?
He says that Dan Ackroyd says that he modeled these character archetypes after the Wizard of Oz character. So you have the Scarecrow, the Tin Man, Cowardly Lion, and you can kind of almost map those to each of them pretty perfectly as the film progresses.
Wow, you just opened my eyes, Tim.
Well, I kind of opened my own eyes today trying to just read up on this movie because I thought I knew all of the, background and trivia, but that was a new detail for me. Oh, let's not step on the first appearance here of one Dana Barrett.
Yes, Miss Sigourney Weaver.
Sigourney Weaver, yes.
Now, this was before or after Aliens? This was after.
This was after Alien. Mm-hmm. Before Aliens, mm-hmm. however, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. A lot of years between those movies.
Mm-hmm. Oh, and then their first appearance of the great and very, very missed Rick Moranis right now in Hollywood. Mm-hmm. Not missed, like he's not dead or anything. He just doesn't act anymore.
He's been retired for 20 years is all.
Yeah. Louis Scully. Hey, hey, Dana, how are you doing? Want to come in for a water? Good exercise, what do you want to do here, huh? Okay, no sweat.
And you can tell.
I'll take a rain check. Got a low sodium thing. Okay, fine.
And you can so tell this is just that guy that she's always constantly having to duck, and she's like so over it.
Of course, he's an accountant. Come on, I'm having a party. Creep down the hall, phone the manager.
And I also heard that this role almost went to John Candy. It was kind of John Candy in mind, but he just sort of took a pass on it.
Oh, he would have been great in it, too.
I think he originally wasn't meant to be just so dorky. Like he was meant to be more, just kind of a yuppie business type guy. But if you get Rick Moranis, I mean, come on.
Yeah, you got to let him do what he wants. Now we see she walks in the apartment, and there's the Ghostbusters on the TV. And her face.
How do you like this? Yeah, how do you like this TV stand she's got?
Oh, that's something. We're ready to believe you. Yeah, that's top notch in 1984 right there.
Look at this. Look at this fucking apartment. Yeah. I mean, talk about Manhattan real estate. Ugh. I mean, this is no chump change, certainly, in today, in 1984. This is ridiculous.
It's got a microwave, which is pretty good for that time.
Mm-hmm. The wood paneling.
Mm-hmm. And she has Stay Puft marshmallows.
She's got a countertop that is also a cook surface.
All of a sudden, these eggs just come popping right out and start cooking away.
This is a great effect, too.
It is. Now, personally, I would have been more upset because I prefer scrambled eggs, not sunny side up. So right. I'm like, if you're going to scare me, at least scare me with the eggs, the style I like it in.
I know. Give me something I can actually eat later.
Yes, come on. And Lord knows what she sees in her fridge with this.
Oh, gosh. Actually, this scene kind of scared me. Not bad, but spooky.
Well, how would you like to open your fridge and see this, demonic dog yelling Zool?
Screaming Zool at you. Yeah. Hate it when that happens. It happens more and more the older you get, I find.
Yeah, here's a line. He says a line here that my friend always says to this day, actually, my best friend Scott. You can't park that here. He always says that. We don't see each other as often. There are times I'll pull up to his place and you can't park that here. I was like, you've been using that line for 35 years and it's still
an innocuous line.
It still makes me laugh. $4,800 for this.
$4,800 they paid for this thing.
Ah, and there's Janine.
Ah.
The great
Annie Potts, right?
Oh, I love her so much.
She's fantastic in this movie.
Yes. No, Dr. Venkman.
It's a good job, huh?
Type something. We're paying for this stuff.
She's kind of my role model right now.
Just sitting there reading a People magazine.
Just to be that disinterested in a job. Oh, here we go.
There you go. And she went, for some reason, she's got a crush on Egon.
Who's sort of, I don't know. He's kind of acting oblivious, but I don't think he really is as oblivious as he seems to be putting on.
Yeah.
And I kind of love their relationship, such as it is. I sort of ship them. I'll go ahead and say it. I ship them. Some people are going to put her and Lewis Tully together. They're fans of the sequel.
Yeah.
I think that's bullshit.
Yeah. No, her and Egon are much better.
Yeah.
She talks about racquetball. That's a very 80s thing.
Mm-hmm. and then he collects spores, molds, and fungus.
There you go. And here comes Dana into the Ghostbusters, and there's Janine just filing her nails.
Yes. Egon also has great pickup lines like Prent is dead.
And then, there's Pete seeing the pretty woman comes flying in.
How many? Waste no time.
That's all we get in here day in and day out. She's the first person that's unemployed, not in the employ of Ghostbusters, to walk in. And then they have her hooked up to something.
Yeah.
Where's she been staying for the last 2 days? Generally, you don't see that behavior in a major appliance.
Right. So we established that she thinks she's telling the truth, that she believes she saw what she saw.
Mm-hmm. And then you, have a guy with a Budweiser can in his hand.
Right, just drinking a beer. Yeah.
It's always reassuring. And then there's Egon with the Doritos.
So we got Egon in a lab coat, Ray drinking a beer, and Bankman in his checkered green and purple button-up shirt.
And he's eating Cheez-Its. Sorry, not Doritos.
Egon eating Cheez-Its, yeah. How professional this outfit is.
With the tub of popcorn on the counter there.
Of course. Which we will see later. Yeah. Nice, nice callback.
And Tobin Spirit. And then, they're doing all the work, and he's like, I'm going to take her apartment and check her out. I'm going to go check out Miss Barrett's apartment. And she, the best part is when they get there, she calls him out on his bullshit the moment they walk through the door.
Yep.
Great panoramic view of New York. Probably a
painting. Oh, my God, yeah. I mean, that's something we shouldn't sleep on. It's just, I mean, this is filmed on location in New York. It is such a snapshot, I would have to say, of New York in 1984, right?
Yeah. I didn't spend that much time in Manhattan at that age, but yeah, it looks like a, you know.
Mm-hmm. It sort of feels like a time capsule.
Mm-hmm. It does. Most of these movies do, which is great. Yeah, he comes in with this, Lord knows what this contraption is supposed to be.
Yes, he's got a wand that he's waving around with some kind of pump. Fucking with her piano.
And he's asking all these questions that have nothing to do with why he's there. More like, you live alone? What's your husband? Mm-hmm. What's your boyfriend? And then she's like, what do you do? What's that? What's that thing? It's tentacle.
He does not answer any of her questions, of course. The bedroom.
Nothing ever happened there. What a crime.
All his little side comments. You know, yeah. He used to being able to get away with this stuff.
Yeah. Ugh, people today have no sense of humor. And you're more like, you're not a scientist, you're more like a game show host. Mm-hmm. Which is pretty true.
Mm-hmm.
More like an, I would say more like an ambulance chaser.
Yeah, really. Especially after that commercial she saw. Yeah, you're right, she's got his number. Look at the swivel, the swivel door here on the kitchen. Yeah.
And you see the eggs.
Mm-hmm. Now he's kind of getting the first inkling of, well, this is a little unusual. It'd be hard to fake this, right?
Yeah, who would put cooked eggs like this on the counter?
I mean, you'd have to cook them and then transfer them to the counter, except they're actually stuck to the counter. Yeah. So it's a little weird.
And now he's checking the fridge.
All these cabinets.
All this junk food.
God damn it, this wasn't here.
I swear to God, he opens up the container, he's like, ooh. Mm-hmm. He's like, what is this?
My mom had that casserole pan in there. My mom has, to this day, actually still has that same casserole pan, and it is probably 35 years old.
Wow. Well, I know there's no animals in here. You actually eat Oscar Mayer bologna.
Yeah, it looked like bologna or salami or something.
Yeah. I don't think you're crazy. Oh, that makes me feel so much better. Now he goes to the, now he's like, that's it, full court press.
Yes.
I'm going to go for it.
Flipping the script. Mm-hmm. Flipping the script on.
We both have the same problem, you.
Mm-hmm.
Go for broke.
And this woman for 15 minutes, 20 minutes. How long did it take to get to her apartment? You know,
I am madly in love with you. You get out of here. And she's just like, what?
I mean, I've heard a lot of criticisms of this scene today where it's kind of like, kind of like Dana Barrett's Me Too moment. Like, creep is refusing to leave her apartment. And it's one of those things where I don't think a scene like this would be written and play as such today. But, I mean, it's one of those, people were so kind of ignorant to that kind of stuff back then. And you just don't think about it. And I don't know that I'm trying to make excuses necessarily, but it's, you know, it's hard not to view this movie through nostalgia goggles. And just knowing that their relationship is not that.
And so now they're celebrating their first client, and their Chinese food is the last of the petty cash. Slow down.
Chowing down some Chinese food.
Slow down. Chew your food, enjoy it, because this is the last meal we can afford, basically.
Yeah. Oh, here we go. Janine, hard at work now.
Yeah, she was a very New York secretary thing, putting her sneakers on for her commute home.
That's right.
Because who really wants to take the train heels? And then she sets the alarm. Look at this. They got two video games and a pinball machine in the background.
Games.
Yeah. And they go down.
Did they have Galaga back then? I don't think so, right?
No, Galaga was back then. Or Galaxian, one of them. Because I remember War Games came out. I think War Games came out the same year. And he's actually, Matthew Broderick's actually playing that in that movie. Now I'm going to pull a Criscolo and look up War Games just so I can confirm myself. All right, 1983. So, yeah. Okay. So Galaga or Galaxian, one of them was up. Because that's the scene when him and Ally Sheedy comes in and she kind of messes up his game at the arcade. So here they are. They show up at the hotel.
Yep, the Sedgwick.
The Sedgwick, yes. Anybody see a ghost? We're not going to be subtle at all. And the stuffy hotel manager shows up.
Yes.
Bow tie and all.
I'm just thinking of what's ahead.
Yeah.
And how they're going to assure him how discreet.
Yeah. They are. And then Ray Stance takes out another thing.
All these instruments.
And then again, here's another relative of mine with the cigar.
Oh, love it. Yes. Yeah.
Very New York, very, very Jewish, if you will. I'm actually
classic New York extra. Right?
Yes. No, somebody saw a cockroach on 12. That must be some cockroach.
Mm-hmm. Bite your head off, man.
Going up, I'll take the next one.
Such a night.
And then puts a cigar in his mouth, which you can't do today. You can't smoke a cigar in the middle of a hotel.
No, indoors, you would not see that indoors. Yeah. Not by any means. Well, there's a no smoking sign.
And then, of course, he's like, I blame myself. So do I. Each one of us is wearing an unlicensed nuclear cell around their back. I love this. Switch me on.
They move away.
And the two of them are like, we're going to.
He might explode.
Yeah, and when Egon's the one moving away, you're going to move away. Because he's the one that built it.
Yeah, he has a lot of subtleties to his character. Yes. Like that I think kind of go unappreciated with Egon. I just, I love the way that he... oh God. Now I'm stepping on the great scene here, blowing up the cart of the poor housekeeper.
Yes, and they blow it away.
What the hell are you doing?
Sorry. That's another thing I use all the time. Whenever sometimes I say sorry, I'm like, sorry. Successful test.
<Mm-mm.
laughs> Let's split up. Yeah, we can do more damage that way. Of course, you know.
Oh, man. Yeah.
His Egon with that whatever thing again. And then again, Peter, now he's smoking in the hallway in the hotel.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And Ray's
got a cigarette lit up.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
More stuff you don't see in movies today. People smoking.
Yes. Well, I think Disney has a no smoking policy in their movies, I think.
Oh, they are most movies today, so.
Yeah, they are.
That would account for it, and the cigarette falls out.
Think, you don't see them step on it. That hotel could have lit on fire.
Yeah, and that might be the least of their worries after this.
And then there's Slimer.
There is Slimer, yes.
And the funny part is, like, the food. I don't know if I noticed it here. The food goes right through him. Well, it kind of gets stuck in there. And Ray,
he's kind of falling through him, yeah.
Ray's not a very good shot. He's getting anywhere close.
He has set the walls on fire with the proton pack.
And then Slimer goes into the wall, and and there goes the housekeeping cart. This guy just wants to get in his room. And there's this strange guy, like, pushing.
This man, is he real?
And then, of course, there's the guy that doesn't believe in anything. Mm-hmm. And there's Slimer. Mm-hmm. He picks up. Come in, Ray.
I saw it. No shit.
It's right here, Ray. It's looking at me. Ugly little spuddy. I think he can hear you, Ray. I love this.
I mean, it's hard to do much more than quote this damn movie. It's just too, it's too quotable.
And then we just see the ghost going at Venkman, and we have no idea what happened. It's almost like Jaws. I think the music playing here is Jaws-esque.
And the way it's shot with these narrow corridors, and it's kind of claustrophobic. It's, you know.
And then he's slimy, which became a very popular phrase.
Yeah.
And of course, there's Peter, the one who doesn't want this shit on him.
Covered in exoplankton.
Yeah. Great. Save some for me. Yeah, I got it.
Oh, I think there's plenty.
I feel so funky.
Yeah.
We'll be right out. And they kind of like go in slowly and set up all for a banquet of some sort. We don't know what's going on in a silent auction, a fundraiser, who knows?
Yeah, something important going on here in this hotel, in this ballroom.
And there's Slimer just going around the chandelier. That's the one who got me.
Worth noting, Slimer, not called Slimer this movie. That comes out of other media, right?
Yeah,
between the toys, the merchandising, and the real Ghostbusters cartoon. That's where he acquires his nom de guerre.
I think they actually, didn't they change the name of the cartoon at some point to Slimer and the Ghostbusters or the real Ghostbusters?
They did, yeah. They kind of rebranded it as Slimer and the real Ghostbusters. Slimer would have his own like little segments of the cartoon. They kind of split it into two parts, I think.
And we get the most important tip from Egon right now. Don't cross the streams. Why?
Don't cross the streams.
It would be bad.
Imagine every molecule in your body exploding at the speed of light.
I'm fuzzy on this whole good bad thing.
Extraordinarily bad.
Yeah. Now this was kind of cool as a kid though in 1984. You know, he's drinking wine and you see it just go right through his ectoplasm, if you will.
God, look at this spread that they're just destroying. Alcohol abuse here.
Yeah. And they kind of stun it a little bit, I guess. Nice shooting techs.
Apparently they just called the Slimer prop that they used in this movie the Onion Head Ghost. I guess it smelled like onions. this thing that
now they're starting to make a ruckus.
Dan Ackroyd called it. His idea is it was the ghost of John Belushi. Oh. That's sort of his character.
Yeah, that would be Belushi. Actually, that's funny. Is that Belushi probably got a part in it that Slimer was based on?
In his own way, yes. Yeah. The flowers are still standing.
Yes, great line. Here we go, confinement stream.
Here we go. Now business is picking up.
Now they're starting to learn their tools here. All right, don't cross the stream. Don't cross the stream. Now you never slam a guy with a positron glare, would you? And not bad effects for 84, too.
I know, right?
The trap is open.
Convinced?
Mm-hmm.
I don't think I'd change this too much today.
No. You wouldn't want to. Look, the ghosts in the Paul Feig one were pretty good, actually, for the most part.
Mm-hmm.
But it was, I don't know, it was just a little different. It was a fine movie. You just have to kind of, you know, gauge it on its own.
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of impossible not to make a movie like this with, what was that, 2016 technology. When you have 2016 technology, you're not going to purposely say, well, how would it look in 1984? I mean, that wasn't really the idea of that movie. So you can't really blame them.
And finally, they come out with the trap all smelly.
Hey, successful catch. And now, let's talk seriously.
I'll talk about price.
And here we go. More subtleties to Harold Ramis's performance here. Look.
Yeah, he's just
kind of coaching him through the bill, right? How to actually itemize their services.
He's like, I'm not paying it. Okay, we're going to put it right back in there.
I won't pay. Yeah.
Thanks so much. A class 5 free roaming vapor.
There you go.
Now we go back to Dana Barrett, who's watching a Ghostbusters. She always Ghostbusters always just seem to pop up on her television.
Mm-hmm. Hard to avoid. I guess they're running a lot of these commercials in the city.
Now we go all the news stories about the Ghostbusters and a montage, if you will.
That's right. We get a great montage here, as all 80s movies must have.
USA Today. USA Today was relatively new then.
Was it?
Oh, yeah. Of course, now I got to look on Wikipedia. But, new USA Today was... it didn't come out. It came out in the fairly early 80s.
Okay. We get a Larry King appearance.
Yes.
Time magazine cover. Mm-hmm. Look at Larry King smoking a cigarette.
Oh, God. September 15th, 1982.
Okay.
That was good. And it took them about 4 or 5 years to actually turn a profit.
Mm-hmm.
And it was actually my birthday. It was my 10th birthday, at least. So I am 10 years older than USA Today.
Congratulations.
Thank you. Share a birthday with Dan Marino and USA Today. that iconic scene of them running through the streets of Manhattan. Mm-hmm. Proton phasers.
Whatever. All the magazine covers. So cool, too.
And Dan, now it's this on the radio.
This is such a... like a Reagan era super 80s movie. You know what I mean? Like where it's just that whole idealistic power fantasy of like, oh, good old fashioned American ingenuity and hard work and a plucky can do attitude can solve any problem. And it's just taken to the extreme with this movie as applied to the problem of ghosts, fucking ghosts of all things. Like, the absurdity of that and just the inherent humor of that, I think, carries this a lot of the way. Oh, here's a great scene.
Yes, Ray and his fantasy, I guess, if you will.
Yes, yes.
He really loves ghosts.
Mm-hmm. I gather this was like supposed to be part of kind of a larger scene that got cut down to, just the the parts that matter, because now he's getting a ghost beach.
Yes, a ghost beach. Just to go back before the ghost beach, we had Casey Kasem and Joe Franklin, very iconic 80s voices there too. And now
we have so much back.
Yeah, now we have somebody applying for a Ghostbuster job, asking him if he believes in anything and everything.
Basically, yeah. The steady paycheck in it, I'll believe in anything you say.
And here they are smoking again.
And we see they are busy. They have been very, very busy.
All of a sudden, it picked up.
Picked up tremendously.
As JR would say, business is about to pick up. So basically, they just say, you got a name? You're hired. Here, just take this.
This is Winston Zeddemore, played by Ernie Hudson, who... I don't know, in a way, kind of gets short shrift in the movie, but also kind of has pound for pound the best lines. Yeah. So it's,
especially later on, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And there's Pete Venkman being a little weird.
Yeah, well.
Trying to be charming. Tracking down Dana Barrett.
Mm-hmm.
Who is a...
she's a cellist, I gather.
Yeah.
And she can afford a hell of an apartment on that cellist salary.
I guess she's doing well for herself.
She's doing pretty damn well.
I don't know what a cellist will get. And then there's a violinist there who's just doing the Afrin. I'm guessing it's like... October, I want to say, based on what they're wearing. Maybe early.
Chilly.
I don't think, it's definitely not summer. I mean, it's not winter.
Yeah, this movie was released in the summer, wasn't it? But it doesn't necessarily, it takes place over kind of a long period of, not a long period of time, but over several months, it seems like.
Uh-huh. Let's see, released... I'm trying to find it. It's not saying the exact date. Looking on the IMDb, June 8th, 1984.
Yeah.
So now
we're getting a lot of backstory now on Zool and how he's like a disciple of this demigod called Gozer and what's in hanging out in her apartment. So sort of an exposition dump, but valuable because we get some character building between the two of them.
Mm-hmm. Awesome. Now they set a date to get together to talk about her her situation. You know, oh, he's just a friend.
Oh, yeah, and the stiff is just very offended by her interaction with this, lowers herself to interacting with the working man.
And he's very concerned about the stiff, though. I didn't get your name, sir, but I hope you feel better.
Yeah.
And he has
we're getting some clash struggles here where they are just almost star-crossed lovers here.
I never thought you could compare Ghostbusters to Romeo and Juliet.
Oh, yeah.
And Winston's now getting his lesson on how to empty a trap.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, pay attention, because he's only going to show you once.
Like this grid, hit this button.
Neutronize your field.
Yeah. Light's green, trap is clean.
And Winston's like, okay.
And there's, again, smoking again.
Smoking again. Got somebody from the EPA wants to check in on this unlicensed nuclear accelerator, as we were informed of earlier.
And there's Janine trying to get, like, more money or a break or something. And he's like, you can do better in food service industry, you know? I quit better jobs than this.
Ghostbusters, what do you want?
And there he is, Walter Peck.
Walter Peck, yes.
And
the great William Atherton.
That's right. Right? Who I have no idea if we're related.
Oh, you should. You should know.
He was one of those 80s villain guys too often.
Die Hard.
Yes, Die Hard. The Pauly Shore vehicle, Biodome.
Oh, my God, yes. Can't forget Biodome.
He actually has kind of a flowing mane in that movie.
Oh. It's unreal.
If you will. And now he's like, he's just trying to get through the bullshit here of the storage facility. And may I see it, please? No.
Again, Reagan's 1980s, where the EPA guy is this crooked, sniveling, weaselly asshole, where, you know, apparently the environmental advocate is like, oh, fuck this guy. We're supposed to hate him. You know, something you probably wouldn't see today, but it is what it is.
He didn't say the magic word. What is the magic word? Please. And then basically he just cuts, he's just like, I'm enough of this guy. I'm just going to cut through it.
I mean, he's not exactly
wrong.
Wrong here. It's just, we're not meant to root for him. You know, it's not what he's saying, but how he's saying it. It's that, it's the 1997 Bret Hart problem. Yes. You know?
Well, I kind of like equate this to, Walking Dead. Where it's like when we meet Negan, had we been following Negan all along, wouldn't Rick have been the bad guy?
Right. Yeah.
So kind of like, yeah, it's kind of fucked up what Negan does, but you know,
from a certain point of view.
Yes, but here's another great line, or probably the first great line of Winston's anymore, where Egon's trying to explain to him.
It's a big Twinkie.
That's a big Twinkie.
Twinkie analogy.
What's your feelings on Twinkies, Tim?
I was about to ask you the same question. So, all right, I'm going to lay it out there. As they're all smoking, once again, all three of them, just imagine how that place must smell. Are Twinkies candy?
No.
I mean, I know they're not in the tournament, but...
No, and I actually am on the tournament, candy tournament committee. Twinkies wasn't even in the discussion. Twinkies are a snack food.
Okay.
So
snack food.
If we do a greatest snack food tournament, yes, Twinkies by all means will be in the cake, I guess.
So okay.
With all snowballs and Hostess cupcakes and fruit pies, that kind of cat.
It is an important distinction because if you open it up to Twinkies, we've got a statue hatching here.
Yeah.
That's not supposed to happen.
Although the candy tournament might be over by the time this gets posted, so congratulations to Reese's Peanut Butter Cups or something. Let's see if I'm if I'm a psychic right now.
Let's do that.
Although Jenny wants Snickers to win.
To answer your question, I'm okay with Twinkies. I feel like they've changed Twinkies since the 80s, though. I think they were better back then, and now they just, I don't know, they've got either too many or too few preservatives and not enough cream filling, and they're just not as good.
Yeah, I love the whole thing in Zombieland where Woody Harrelson's just looking for that Twinkie.
Oh, yeah.
I know. Twinkies are something like I'll eat like once a year, if that, because it's just it's like those things like a Big Mac or whatever. It's like, you know, you eat those as much when you're younger, and it's like once in a while you just get that hankering for it. Now, a Chocodile is I actually prefer.
Oh, a Chocodile. Wow.
That's basically a chocolate-covered Twinkie. You
know? Oh, yeah.
So... Mm. Now, back to the movie, we're actually watching Dana comes home, and Lewis is having his party. She invited him to that. She's not going to come. And she informs him she has a date. And he has a look on his face like somebody shot his dog.
Oh, no. Such a hangdog look to him. Yeah, like,
you feel so bad. She's like, oh, that's okay. You can bring him over. All right. We will.
Like, okay, I'll make an appearance, basically.
Yeah.
I mean, she's in her sweats. She is in for the night. She is having none of this bullshit.
I know we keep talking about your talk of pop colors, but you know, one of her weaknesses, sweatpants.
Well, mine too.
There you go. Yeah. And Dana Barrett's now taking them off.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
She must have been at the gym, I'm saying, because she's got like some kind of tights or something.
Well, now she's got like what we would call leggings today, which weren't really a thing in the 80s. So. No. Got wearing leggings under her sweatpants.
So her mother calls, and she's got to
And she sounded somewhat exasperated to take her mother's call, which sort of tells you a little bit more about her character without taking a lot of time to do so. You know, just some good economy of script there.
Got the point across. And then, what the fuck is happening in the kitchen?
Okay, so I'm kind of talking a lot because this is the scene that would scare the piss out of me.
Oh yeah, if you're a little Tim Capel, you know, and you picture yourself in that, you know, that chair.
Yeah, she says, "Oh shit!"
And hands. I mean, yeah, I think I probably jumped in the movie theater.
I mean, this is like genuinely terrifying.
Yeah, because I'm 11 years old. I think my birthday's in September, so I had to have seen this in the summer. So yeah, you're being held by arms into your kitchen that's got like lights coming out of it and some kind of demonic dog looking thing.
Hands coming up out of your upholstery and grabbing you in intimate places.
Yes, one hand does cop a feel.
Demonic beast that is now somehow in your utility room and your couch takes off. It's just, and the music, of course, puts it over the top. Mm-hmm. Ugh.
And now we go over to Lewis's party, where he's basically using the whole thing as a tax write-off.
Right, which he says, this is why I invited in clients instead of friends.
Which I don't think Lewis has any friends, really.
Another one of those lines that's just sort of overlooked, but is hilarious.
And then we have appearance by the second of the Kasems, Jean Kasem.
Oh, here we go.
She was actually married to Casey Kasem at the time, this blonde. Who was, I don't know if you watched Cheers. She was Nick Tortelli's new wife after he left Carla.
Okay, I got you.
And she was saying, hi, gang of Cheers, kind of thing. And then here's a, introducing himself to the next set of guests who these people are like, who are these people? And look, another dog.
And we've got a terror dog in his utility room too, which he's oblivious to.
Yeah. Anybody want to play Parcheesi?
Good Lord.
Then the 1984 effects come out, which it still, again, aren't that bad for the time.
Mm-hmm. I mean, and, the actual like animatronics and the models look pretty decent. It's just when they do like the stop motion stuff that's a little bit, you know. But they don't linger on that too long.
Yeah, and I love this woman because everyone, oh shit,
he just takes me off.
There's a bear loose in my apartment. I love how the doormat's making the fun of him. And then here comes the bear, knocks the doormat over. And this is Central Park West too. So these guys, his accounting business must be doing pretty well.
Yeah, no doubt.
And there's this restaurant here in.
I know this kind of random restaurant. I'm always. I always kind of wondered.
It probably was a real place actually back then. I don't know if it's still there. I couldn't tell you last time I was in Central Park, but you know, of course, typical New York. Nobody's really paying attention. They see him and they're like, "Who cares?" He turns around. Nice doggy, cute little pooch. Maybe I got a milk bone. Now look, I have a dog. And it's only about 50% of the time I have a milk bone in my pocket.
Yeah, well, he doesn't even have a dog.
I know.
And he's also clearly not a dog person that he thinks this is any kind of dog.
Yes.
A terror dog is what it is.
A cougar went berserk at a party.
Cougar whippers. Again, something else that's taken on kind of a different meaning here in 2019. That would not have had a double meaning in 1984.
Oh, I would love to be at a party where a cougar goes berserk. Oh, that would be so much fun.
It's me.
talking about Hachimachi.
Here's the cougar in question.
Yes. Although she's probably not a cougar at the time, though. She's probably in maybe early 30s, if that.
Probably comfortably in her 30s, I'd feel like. Because she had to have been in her 20s in Alien, which was 1979.
Yeah, so she's born in 49. So she's roughly 33, 34, I guess.
Yeah.
Yeah, so.
Is that right?
Mm-hmm. And she's Are you the key master? No, slam. Are you the key master? Right. Yes.
Come on.
Who are you? And he's just like, "What the fuck happened here?"
Yeah. And so we're learning she is Zool. Mm-hmm. She is the gatekeeper.
And she is not the same Dana he met before.
Right.
Are we still going out?
She is. So she is Zool, which is the kind of demonic entity that's been haunting her apartment. We will learn more about what's been going on with Louis Tully as well. Mm-hmm. What I want to know, was he experiencing hauntings like her, you know, prior to any of this? That's sort of a unexplored side story, perhaps.
Yeah, like we need like a one-shot of Louis Tully.
Yeah, there you go. That's right. DVD extra.
More like a guideline than a rule. I want you inside me. I can't. Go ahead. Nope, wait. Sounds like I already got two people in there. Might be a little crowded.
Says it might be a little crowded. Yeah.
he definitely knows, like, she's definitely, something's going on here that, you know, is not right. I want to talk to Dana. There is no Dana, only Zool.
Yeah.
Zool, you nut. And Sigourney were probably one of the worst ventriloquist acts ever. There is no Dana, only Zool.
Yeah, the voice just...
Yeah, she doesn't really...
Again, just iconic scene.
Yes. And...
I hope people are watching along with us because it's sort of impossible to. I think it's sort of impossible to get much of out of this podcast without it. If you've never seen this movie, you've got to treat yourself by all means. Just you know, again, every line is so quotable, we can hardly do more but quote the movie and laugh, as you do on Laugh in Theater.
Yes. Which is kind of the point of why I started this show. I actually had an idea for another show, but I kind of took the cue from Jenny and said, you know what? There's enough room for another live watch show, but you know, she's got the horror stuff. Let me do the comedy stuff. No, I thought of doing a podcast all about quoting movies, and I was like, is that really sustainable? You know,
well, it's a great place to start.
Yeah. Well, I mean,
Dana levitates off of her bed.
And now we learn who the Keymaster is now.
That's right, yeah. Things are coming together.
And through Central Park, he finds somebody to talk to. Some of the carriage horses.
They were, you know, near yet so far away. He was just in his apartment. He is the Keymaster, and now he's looking for his gatekeeper.
Vince Clark, the
streets. Yeah, New York. Talking to the horse.
His eyes light up red. Wait for the sign. All prisoners will release.
I love to see where he...
Then he knocks the bag ladies, cans over. What an ass. Dropping off or picking up.
The setting, the scene here in New York City, just kind of as a character onto itself. You just don't find in many movies. I mean, as many movies as are set in New York City, I don't think any but this makes it come to life quite so much.
And then, of course, the police bring them to Ghostbusters because they figured, like, you know, Bellevue doesn't want them.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Seems like you guys might know what to do with him.
And then Janine's taking the opportunity to kind of hit on Egon a little more. You're so brave to bring him in. And now we see some kind of colander on his head.
Right, with wires attached to
it. And on the screen, though, we see the demon dog.
The terror dog, yeah.
The terror dog, sorry. Mm-hmm. I sound like I'm one of the kids in Stranger Things when I see demon dog.
Yeah, really. That's a great kind of juxtaposition where you see him and then on the, I guess like the EKG readout or whatever it's supposed to be, it's the terror dog, and they're just sort of, Egon and Janine are like, what is going on?
I love how he tells this story now. The form of the giant slur. Oh, many slums and zools knew what it was to be roasted that day, I could tell you. Like he's like you don't know, man.
And here's the popcorn again.
Yes, there it is. Just smelling the outside of it. I have a terrible feeling that something awful is going to happen to you.
She says she's very psychic.
Hold me.
You get the impression they were just having a nice night before this happened. Just sort of in their own, perhaps maybe just in their own heads, but they were hanging out, they were doing their thing, and then this happens.
And a possessed Nebuchadnezzar accountant shows up on their doorstep.
Exactly.
Now, I want to know, where did he get 300 cc's of Thorazine?
You know, I was kind of wondering that same question, because he's a... He is a PhD. He's a doctor. He's a psychologist, but he's not a psychiatrist. He doesn't have an MD. He should not be administering however many cc's of anything.
Yeah, and he thinks we should get the Keymaster and the Gatekeeper together. And he goes like, no, we're not doing that. We need Ray.
Yeah, so he whacked her up on Thorazine, as he put it.
Now, is Thorazine still around these days, or is that something? What would that be equate to?
I mean, it's probably called something else, but I've always kind of thought of it in terms of like more high octane Valium or Xanax, something to really knock you on your ass. But it, I mean, yeah, it may very well may very well be one of those things like quaaludes that you don't really hear about anymore.
Well, it's according to the Google, it's chlorpromazine. It is an antipsychotic.
Okay.
So let's see.
Not more like lithium, maybe.
Yeah. Although in the UK,
this is irresponsible of me to speculate.
So now we're talking about biblical stuff here with.
Fun scene here with Ray and Winston driving, just kind of comparing notes.
Yeah, it's like, what do you think? Is this Judgment Day? Is like, is this why we're so busy? Because shit's going down.
I mean, he has a good point. It's like, why the hell are we so busy here lately? All of a sudden.
Maybe the dead are rising from the grave.
And isn't it kind of a bad sign that we're so busy?
Yeah, it's kind of like, you know, you go into the business. You decide, like, oh, I'm just going to be a zombie killer. And, you know, if you're really busy, that means shit's gone down.
Yeah.
Oh, Twin Towers.
Oh, yeah. That was a great shot anyway, that kind of panoramic zoom that they did. But. Yeah, then you close on the Twin Towers there, which, you know, kind of takes your breath away.
Yeah, and then here's Walter Peck. He's back. And now he's got an envelope, a large envelope, if you will, with a Con Ed guy and a cop. I mean, that's the trifecta right there, the EPA, Con Ed, and NYPD.
I mean, that looks very official.
Yes.
Especially. And you're in New York City.
Of course, she goes, you need like a, I watch TV. You need like a warrant or something.
You need a warrant or a writ or something.
And of course, he just whips one out. It's kind of like, okay.
I guess she's getting her legalese from, what would it be at the time? Maybe,
L.A. Law.
Hill Street Blues or something?
Yeah, Hill Street Blues, that's right. Hill Street,
was that around back then?
Yeah, Hill Street Blues, yeah, about that time.
Early 80s.
Mm-hmm. That was before NYPD Blue, I know that. Mm-hmm. Hill Street Blues song theme in my head now.
Mm. There you go.
Yeah, and now Bankman's back. And Vince Clortho is just doing whatever everybody else is doing.
I like Egon kind of holding his own in this scene, giving it right back to Walter Peck.
And Walter Peck's like, you know what? Fuck you. I got a cop. Now you're done. Like, I love the Con Ed guy over here going, he has no idea what's going on.
Yeah, I've never seen this thing before or anything like this.
Shut off. And they're all, he's hearing like from one person to another person. I just don't know.
Right. And this is the, we should point out, this is the trap where they store all of the free roaming vapors and other spirits they collect. I wonder what the capacity of a trap is. Like, do they have to, you know, is it like an external hard drive or you're going to run out at some point? You know, you've just... You've downloaded too much porn and you need a new one.
Well, I'm guessing the traps are like zip drives, little thumb drives, and then that's like the external hard drive right there.
Yeah.
And of course, Egon just gives the whole little boom signal, and the Con Ed guy, oh shit,
oh shit, yeah.
I love it. And then there's the Keymaster just smiling and, you know. Right. Everybody's just hauling ass now to get out of there.
Screaming, clear the building. Which, I mean, to his credit, Egon said this. He likened it to setting off a nuclear bomb in the heart of the city.
Yes.
Which is about to go down right now.
And that kind of wakes up Dana from her Thorazine coma.
Yeah, all this paranormal, just concentrated paranormal activity is causing her to stir.
I don't know. I think one of the upcoming scenes might have scared me a little more as a kid.
Oh, really?
Yeah, the cab. Coming up.
Oh, I know what you're talking about.
Yeah, it's definitely a sign going out of business. And then Ray finally shows up. There must have been traffic on the bridge.
I know. Yeah, they were a little late.
You know, and then the Keymaster's just wandering off. Mm. Whose job was it to keep an eye on him? Now the other Ghostbusters are back together, and they figure out the Keymaster's gone.
Yeah, they still got to deal with Walter Peck, though.
Yeah,
it's just, even though it's his fault that this happened.
Basically, yeah. And then Egon kind of loses his shit here.
Oh, yeah. He's going for the throat.
Yeah.
Your mother!
Your mother! And then, here we go. Just shit's flying out of the Ghostbusters right there. Again, another Twin Tower shot. With mm-hmm. the Empire State Building in the foreground.
Empire State Building, yep.
We can see the Hudson River from here. And there's just stuff flying all around the city.
And once again, we can't hear it, but I know you hear the same
the music
right now. Mm-hmm. Magic.
Yeah. Oh, it's magic.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, and then who comes out of the sewer? What? A ghost.
Yep. Kind of praying mantis-looking ghost.
Yeah, this is the part that probably freaked me out a little bit when I saw it the first time.
Yeah.
Guy gets in the cab. And then there's now what happened? Decrepit. What do you think happened here? Do you think there was a cab driver and then this ghost just like did that to him?
Yeah, you sort of wonder like,
or did the ghost
does
like,
how you like does the way that you lived your life somehow influence what you're going to become as a ghost? Like, I mean, Slimer is certainly not very humanoid looking.
Yeah, right? Eating hot dogs.
Yeah, the cab driver is like just a zombie.
Yeah.
So it's just, I mean, I gather they're all just different varieties of ghost, but I don't know. Has something to do with the way they died or how they live.
It's, could be.
They don't really get into that.
What a great shot from that apartment, I'll tell you. What a view. Yeah.
So cool.
And that's the, what is it, upper penthouse of Spook Central is it referred to?
Right. Yep.
Yeah, she's just looking out, and then now they're in jail. This is one of my favorite scenes, too.
I know.
Because like, they got this, like, you know, they're allowed to bring these blueprints in there. And then a poster. And I love how all the other guys in the jail cell are all looking. Everybody getting
crowd around.
Everybody getting this so far? Have you got...
Hey, they got nothing better to do.
The architect was either a certified genius or an authentic wacko. Mm-hmm.
And I want to say there was like a Ghostbusters video game that goes into the background of all this, of like who that architect was and how he sort of set these events into motion and just a lot of that, for lack of a better term, mythology and backstory. Russell Sellers is yelling at us through the podcast device right now. But, yeah, I mean, there's like a video game that's sort of an unofficial sequel.
I can't.
That is, yeah, as close as you're going to get to like a Ghostbusters 3 sort of thing.
So she's the upper penthouse of the Tobin Spirit Guide, mentioned again, performed a lot of unnecessary surgery.
Yeah. All these creepy sort of suspect details of, you know, early 20th century Manhattan architecture, I guess.
I guess now everybody wants to hear the story of Igor Shandor.
Mm-hmm.
I love how intently they're all like looking in.
Bizarre rituals, yeah.
It looks like it's gonna actually happen. So you better be good, for goodness sake. Whoa, somebody's coming. We have to get out of here.
So at this point, it could almost turn into a crossover with Night Court. Get these guys out of jail.
Sumerian, not Babylonian. Yeah, big difference. And then Winston's just like, all right, fuck this. Oh, here, Reginald Vell Johnson.
Reginald Vell Johnson.
Right there.
Here we go.
Pre-Die Hard and pre-Family Matters.
Man. Did he ever not play a cop? I don't know.
Now, Die Hard, would could I do that on this show? I don't know. I don't know if you consider that a cover.
See, that's where it's God, it is so funny and so quotable.
Yeah. And now finally the Keymaster and the Gatekeeper. Lewis is finally gonna get Dana.
Yeah, in some form or fashion.
Yes. You know, hey, I don't know if she looked for studs or anything before she blew that wall out. I don't know.
Right. What I wonder, was Zool always female? I mean, Vince Clortho sounds like a male name. I don't know how they did it in Sumerian times, but Zool, sort of ambiguous.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of wonder what Zool and Vince Clortho got up to back in the olden days.
Now, I have a question just popped in my head. So they were the two dogs, right, in the statues, right across from each other. But yet mm-hmm. they had to go possess people to get together in human form, I guess?
Yeah, it's sort of a little bit unclear. It seemed to be a requirement that they needed to be in human form.
Okay.
I think that the idea is that the terror dogs are just kind of a mm-hmm. the expression, the manifestation of these spirits, but they can't really get anything done unless they are like flesh and blood human beings.
Here we are in the mayor's office. Lenny, the mayor. Now, this guy's, mm-hmm. I forget the actor's name, but he's been in a shit ton of stuff too. He's another one.
Another that guy actor.
Hey, that guy. Let's see if I can find him here.
Shut off by Dickless here.
Is this true? Yes, this is true. This man has no dick. Well, that's what I heard. David Margulies. Let's see. Is he still alive?
Oh, yeah.
No, he passed away January 2016.
Mm.
Best known for Ghostbusters, Ghostbusters 2, Ace Ventura. He was the doctor at the place that Ray Finkel was at. Those of you know your Ace Ventura trivia. And then the bishop shows up.
Mm-hmm.
I love this part. How are you, Lenny? We're in a real bind here, Mike. You're looking good, Mike.
And of course, the church is not going to take any position on, you know, the religious implications of ghosts.
Well, personally, I think it's a sign from God, but don't quote me on that. And then, Peter, that's a smart move, Mike. What am I going to do here, John? Now Winston pleads his case.
Here we go.
I got to tell you, these things are real. I've seen shit that will turn you white.
Oh, my God. That's an all-time line from this movie.
You see Mr. Pecker. We mean biblical. He means Old Testament. Again, probably one of the top three quotable lines in the movie coming up, right?
Yeah.
In a minute. Mm-hmm. The dead rider's grave, human sacrifice.
Yeah.
Here you go, Tim. You could say it.
Dogs and cats living together. Mass hysteria.
Yeah. That, and it has a lot of times you can use it. For a lot of applications. What if you're wrong? We'll go to jail. It's peaceful. We'll enjoy it. But if I'm right, we can stop this thing. You, Lenny, will have saved the lives of millions of registered voters.
Think of it.
He just knows how to tell people what they want to hear.
Mm-hmm. Selling it.
Yeah.
Salesman.
Gets the nod from the Archbishop. Peck's just like, oh, fuck. Hello, this. Get him out of here.
Points.
Yes. I'm going to miss him.
The last we'll see of him, though.
No, he gets his final cup up and come up and later.
That's right.
What do you need from me? And then we see the National Guard showed up.
Again, just speaks to how just such that 80s America movie. It's like mm-hmm. we've got a paranormal like invasion of demonic spirits, and it's like, yeah. We got that. I mean, it's their slogan, right? Who are you going to call?
Yeah.
Just They're going to come in.
We'll give you a police escort.
Take care of business. We've got it. Just clear us a path. We'll take care of it. Nothing we can't handle.
And you just see the ominous dark clouds over the, yeah. Now we got all the different groups here. You got the, the end of the world people here, the rabbis, you got the Hasidics over here praying, you got the Catholics, you got Hasidim, not Hasidim, I'm
you
sorry.
You got the punks.
You got Hare Krishnas are in here. Michelle Sano, are they still around, Hare Krishnas?
Oh, God. I couldn't tell you that.
Yeah. That was a kind of an 80s thing. You know, parodied in an airplane and other movies. Repent. The end is near.
You've got, above all else, some very over-exuberant extras.
Yes. I'm in a movie.
Yeah.
I love that dress, Grandma. You got a date with a ghost. Ray stands the heart of Ghostbusters. They love you, Ray.
Yeah, you got a heart, right? He's the Tin Man.
Is he the Tin Man? So who's the Scarecrow?
So I guess the Scarecrow has got to be Egon. All brains,
right. Yeah,
and well, Venkman has got to be the Cowardly Lion, thinking he's lacking in courage, but really comes through in the clutch.
Uh-huh.
I guess Winston's odd man out, unfortunately. Yeah, as he often is. See Dorothy? I don't know.
Maybe Dark Toto.
Toto. Yeah. It's an unfavorable comparison.
I don't know. If I'm in that crowd and I see this shit going on up there, I'm not hanging around.
Yeah, so. I'm not hanging out. I think I'm probably getting into a fetal position.
Yeah, at this point. And the ground starts to break up. I'd be like, out of here.
Yeah, you're literally falling into cracks in the street.
I would be in Central Park so fast. You know, police car goes in there.
Yeah, a car is getting swallowed now.
I mean, yeah, people in movies don't seem to run from things. It's like we're, I think it was like, he loves it when we talk about him. Jason Sherman mentioned about Independence Day. When they're all in the beginning, when all the ships start gathering, and you know, the yes. girl played Slater's girlfriend in the college, Saved by the Bell, the college years, is the stripper friend of Vivica A. Fox, goes up to the top of one of the Capitol Records buildings, and they're like, blurry. Like, people are just stupid in movies. Oh, thank God the Ghostbusters survived, because we were fucked if they didn't.
I was going to say, I think the difference here, you know, they're New Yorkers. Yeah. You know, they're not going to back down from this.
No, we kind of don't.
Fist pumping action once again. Yes.
Ghostbusters. Yes, very.
People got their signs, their banners. They're just, you know, making a party out of it.
All right, we're going in. My son went as a Ghostbuster probably about 4 years ago, 3-4 years ago, with the blow up proton pack. Probably nothing like Russell's outfit, but still.
No, his is quite professional. I mean, yeah. I at least had the old hard plastic thing that, you know, Kenner? Was that the toy line? Or was it Playmates? Now I'm getting. I think it was Kenner.
Well, Kenner was the ones who made Star Wars toys. So
yeah, Kenner made Star Wars, of course. Galoob? No.
Yeah, where
all
are
these defunct companies now? Anyway, they made a proton pack back in the day. So
speaking of proton packs, it looked like Zool and Vince got busy, and Vince had the biggest smile on his face.
Yep.
But before that, another great Venkman line. You know, where are we as they're going up the stairs? We're somewhere in the teens. All right, well, let me know when we get to 20. I'm going to throw up.
Yeah.
And then they finally made it to the 22nd floor.
Yep. And this is what I mentioned before in the terrible NES game. Really makes you realize and feel their pain, because that's about... felt like about 90% of the game is having to climb stairs and getting killed and not having a lot of options for true gameplay.
So they finally get to Dina's apartment, and the door kind of just falls down.
Mm-hmm.
And see Dina's poor piano all destroyed. Her whole apartment is gone.
What a shame. Yeah, I mean, this whole corner loft here has just been detonated.
Yeah, I wonder what a corner loft in Central Park West would cost you.
Good Lord.
In 1984, I probably couldn't afford $1984. Yeah.
I mean, let alone, hey, 1984 would have been probably a nightmare.
Where do these stairs go? They go up.
They go up.
And, this is another Venkman. Go ahead, go. Come on. I'll be right behind you.
All I know is that watching this movie, clearly I should have aspired to be a cellist.
Yes. Well, no, it's never too late, Tim.
Or, I guess, an accountant.
Yeah.
You know.
And now I got, like, some purple...
Yeah.
Purple.
Lightning raining down mm-hmm. on Vince Clortho and Zool,
mm-hmm.
the disciples of Gozer.
Not to be confused with the disciples of Apocalypse. You know, Skull and Apel here.
Oh, God. And you get a recreation of the gang wars here in 84 New York.
And here they go. They're being turned back into the terror dogs.
Yes, they have turned back. I guess it's like Gozer has no further use for them, really. So yeah. They have reverted to this form.
Well, the key has gone into the gate, so to speak. So
yeah, they've connected. Yeah,
because you can't really tell. I mean, you can't really lift up these terror dog skirts to tell what they are.
No, so. No, you can't tell them apart. Yeah,
so. All
As Venkman puts it, okay, she's a dog.
Probably one of the most fun closing scenes.
It is, yeah. And this whole set is just really so imaginative.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, this was the whole set for that Ghostbusters attraction they used to have at Universal.
Oh, okay.
And they had somebody come out as Gozer and everything. And they kind of recreate. Is part of the scene.
Yeah.
And she's petting her doggy.
Gozer is whatever it wants to be.
It's not going to get like by talking. Us. Like talking pop. Go get her, Ray. I tell you, also watching with the sound off, you kind of get that nonverbal communication. Uh-huh. You really start to pick up on things you may not have seen before.
Yeah, just the body language between all of them.
I love this. The Dilly designated goes out to Gazarian. Good evening. He turned into mm-hmm. his best, like, Walter Cronkite, I think. Return to your place of origin.
Or nearest convenient parallel dimension. That ought to do it. Thanks very much.
Are you a god? He's like, yeah,
another great line. Another great line coming up here.
Yes. No. Then. Die.
She sends them flying with bursts of lightning from her fingertips.
I think that was more of a warning shot because she very easily could have just thrown them off the building.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, the movie could have ended right here.
Mm-hmm.
They're kind of like on the edge right there.
Yeah, they did catch a break when you put it that way.
And Winston kind of gives Ray some shit here now.
Well, you know, at least this event did not cause a blackout. We do still see city lit up. Yeah, Winston with some ass. Are you a god? You say yes.
All right, now they're pissed. This chick is toast. They're like, all right, boys, get your packs. Got your stick? Holding it. I never caught that before, holding your stick.
Mm.
Heat them up. Smoking. Ready?
Make them hard.
I love this line. Let's show this prehistoric bitch how we do things downtown.
Yeah.
And she just flips over it. Does her best Ricochet impression.
Yeah, really.
Nibble little minx, isn't she?
Pieces out on him.
Aim for the flat top. She's just like, okay, bring it on, and she vaporizes.
And I understand this portraying Gozer as a Yugoslavian model. Did she do any other acting work?
Oh, I have no idea. We could try to find out. Slavitska Jovan is the woman's name. She's still alive, as far as I can see.
Okay.
She did She was in Body Double, House on Haunted Hill. That's a fucked up movie. I don't know if you have you ever seen Body Double.
Yeah, it is a fucked up movie.
That one scene where the girl gets killed with the drill or whatever that is. Oh, that's brutal.
Huh. So she's done some work.
Yes. So.
Yeah, so Gozer is whatever it wants to be, and Gozer kind of appeared as that kind of androgynous humanoid type of figure has now disappeared and
is going
to come back as what you want it to be.
Vogus, no, as well as Vogus, Gozer's kind of a voice now of the cloud, and then they tell you Vogus Silmar, whoever the fuck that is, the Destructor, is telling him, she's like, what form is it going to come in? You pick. How do you want to die, basically, she's asking him.
Choose your own adventure.
Yes. So if we think of J. Edgar Hoover is going to come and destroy us. So empty your heads. We only got one shot at this.
Look at Ray.
The choice is made. The traveler has come. Nobody choose anything.
Nobody chose anything.
Egon, no. Winston, no. Pete, no. And then Ray's just like...
poor Ray.
What did you do, Ray?
Another one of those lines that I think people say, and they don't even necessarily know where it's from. I think that's like a lot of things from this movie.
I'm trying to think of nothing. Look. No, it can't be. What is it? What did you do, Ray? Oh, shit. And you just see this, like, sailor man coming through with, like, you know, looks like the Pillsbury Doughboy and, you know, Popeye the Sailor Man had a baby.
Yeah, that's a good way of putting it.
Well, and maybe throw a little Michelin man.
A little Michelin. Yep, there you go.
And he's just like walking through. It's like, what the hell is
this? I'm just marking out at this point. Yeah. It's like, how did you, this is the type of thing that, like, you put it in the script and it's one of those, like, there's no way. Like, we're going to just redline this. We cannot film this. This has got
to
go.
So, wait, you try to tell me that at the end of this movie, a giant Marshmallow Man is the big bad.
This is your climax. You're really going to pull this off. How are we supposed to do this?
I thought something that never could have destroyed us. Mr. Stapuff, nice thinking, Ray. And you can definitely see he's starting to lose it.
Yeah, he's talking about campfires and all this nonsense from his childhood.
Ray has gone bye-bye. What do you got left? Sorry, I'm terrified beyond the capacity for rational thought. And there he is just walking down the street.
Look, honest answers from Egon.
You know, the fact that this giant marshmallow, but then, like, he looks up at them and they're like, uh-oh, mother pus bucket. And there's Peck again.
Yep, here we see Peck.
And he steps on a church, and that crosses the line. Nobody steps on a church in my town, and they decide to, like, start hitting him.
Now the attack.
Yeah. Now this is not a very good choice by Gozer. Gozer should have been like, no, I'll pick something else. Because, you know, marshmallows and fire, you know, does not a good combination.
We see what's going to happen here.
So I don't know how he does that, sends the fire back at him. And now
it's like he created some kind of plume by hugging the building.
I love this. This Stay Puft. He's a sailor. He's in New York. Let's get this guy laid. We won't have any trouble. So now he's climbing very King Kong-esque. Now, Egon tells us the one thing we were told we should never do.
Right.
Cross the stream. No, you say crossing the streams would be bad.
fantastic callback, though.
Yeah.
You know, the whole, if you're going to establish you can't cross the streams, then you have to cross the streams.
Yeah.
You just don't have a movie if you don't.
Yeah, there's definitely necessarily a very slim chance we won't die. I love, we can't hear now. I love how his voice kind of cracks when he gives the line. I love this plan. Now, Winston Zeddemore was making $11.5 a year.
Yeah. That's wow. Not... In 1984, New York.
I don't think Winston lived in New York proper. Maybe New Jersey.
Could be. Yeah, could be. You're right. He's a commuter.
Yeah, and they accepted their favor.
$11.5. Just, man.
I see you on the other side, Ray. Nice working with you, Dr. Venkman. It kind of likes to say, you know what, we got to do this for the greater good. So they get all four streams together and fire that fucker in there. And it reverses. And that's kind of like the whole place just blows up.
Yeah, kind of like turns the Stay Puft guy inside out. It's yeah. Sort of.
Almost like the Indiana Jones face melting scene.
A little bit, yeah. Sort of similar effect there.
And next thing you know, it's marshmallows everywhere. And there's Walter Peck getting his final comeuppance. That's an awful lot of marshmallow.
Which, shoot shaving cream, as yes. I understand it.
Usually.
Gallons and gallons of shaving cream. Mm-hmm.
It's often used in commercials and stuff, and, you know. There's videos on online and shows you how they do those things to make stuff look.
Yeah.
Now we see the aftermath of crossing the streams.
They are still alive somehow.
Yes. There's Ray and Winston together covered in marshmallow cream shaving stuff. Yep. He finds their Spengler also covered head to toe. So I love how these three guys are covered. And then we finally see Pete Venkman with a little bit in his hair. I mean, he literally has like nothing on him. It's hysterical.
You know, he was kind of due for a break after getting slimed earlier and just some of the stuff he went through.
Mm-hmm. You okay? Yeah. Okay. Fine. I'm good.
And then kind of just look him up. You know?
Oh, smells like barbecue dog. Venkman, I'm sorry. I just forgot. I love that he just looks at him. He's just covered.
Begs the question, are we really going to kill Sigourney Weaver in this movie?
No. No, we see a hand come out of the dog.
Mm-hmm.
That may be a callback to earlier in the movie with the arms coming out.
Well, yeah.
Maybe.
Never really thought that. That's a good point.
Maybe ask Russell what he thinks one day.
Uh-huh. Might just do that.
Well, and then yes, they open it up, and there she is.
Mm-hmm. This kind of shell of burnt, crispy dog. Pulled her out of.
And there's Lewis. There's Lewis with just the head on. Somebody turn the lights on. Check on the little guy. It takes three of them to go help him while she's trying.
I know, right? With his glasses. He's got his glasses on. Yeah.
Well, the dog was probably nearsighted anyway, so. Mm. She's kind of just like hungover.
Yeah. Hi. I wonder if they remember anything they did, you know?
Probably not.
Seems like they don't, but it's like, does it come back to them at any point? Like, is it awkward now that they, you know?
Well, I mean, thank God there weren't iPhones back then.
Unlocked her gate or whatever.
Yes. First thing he asks, who does your taxes? You're very fortunate, Mr. Tully. I know.
I know.
Felt great. I would like to get a sample of your brain tissue. Okay. Winston, I love this town.
Yeah.
And then we get them come downstairs.
Mm-hmm. Kind of ends on this sort of interesting montage.
Yeah. Of them all kind of, you know, Peter finally gets the...
Speaking of awkward, yeah, this kiss is sort of, it's always hard for me to think of Bill Murray as like a romantic interest for anyone. Like, just, I don't know. It's always a little bit weird and off.
Yes, Dan Ackroyd had to light up. He's probably been waiting a while for that.
Man, you could take a shot for every time somebody smokes a cigarette in this movie and you'd be lit.
Yes, and then look, Egon and Janine finally get together. Yeah. Poor Lewis comes out. Hey, anybody want to interview me? And the guys from with the, you know, from Bellevue come over. The paramedics like, I want to go with them. No, come on.
Could drum up some more clients, maybe.
Well, you never know. And there are people in prison or in mental hospitals that need their taxes done.
That's right.
Yeah. And then we got, you know, them loading up the Ecto-1.
Mm-hmm.
And there's the doorman. He still got his tie on, I got to tell you.
Yeah. Another day in New York.
Yeah, it really kind of is.
Day in the life.
Although nobody would ever back up, let you out. Yes, and the song being sung by the great Ray Parker Jr.
Yeah, so
he only had one
off. Huey Lewis, right? But nobody cares. They settled. It doesn't matter. And there's the shirt.
Yeah, there's the shirt. That was the one of the Hare Krishnas.
Right. Yep.
Yeah, Ray Parker Jr. His only other song that I know of is The Other Woman. I don't know if you've ever heard that song. That probably was in the 80s tournament, 80s song tournament. Which may come back. Shh, don't die, Mike.
Yeah, I was going to say, shh.
May get a reboot. Who knows? And now we have Slimer coming right at us. Oh, shit! That was me, 11-year-old Andy. And my sister gave me, like, the dirtiest look.
Yeah.
Well, okay. That was a great, great flick.
That is, God. So, what do you think, like, in terms of the question, does it hold up? Like, you and I, it's almost automatic that we're going to still laugh at the same jokes because we almost have it memorized. We know all the lines. It's going to get us. Do you think, like, you said your daughter was not as into this, right?
Well, part of it was annoying me because I didn't have it on DVD or Blu-ray at that point. So I DVR'd it off AMC, and the sync was off. So I think part of the time was me just complaining about the sync being off between the audio and video. But no, she, you know, she thought it was okay. I mean, I haven't shown it to my son yet. We did regret going to see the new one, not in 3D, because I actually heard the 3D effects were really good in the Paul Feig one, because it had a letterbox kind of thing to it. So you actually saw the ghost kind of coming out a little more.
Oh, wow.
And the way they shot it, yeah. So, I mean, for us, it holds up because we grew up with this. It's like, you know, I mean, I showed my kids The Goonies, and they actually did enjoy it. Like, I remember this was like, I think it was like 2 years ago or something like that. So my kids are 5 years apart. So picture of my son, probably 10-ish. My daughter's 15-ish or so, 14 maybe. I don't know. So it was like a weekend. They were with me, and you know, I think I had just shown him the Ghostbusters either the night before, or we watched it in the morning at breakfast. And I literally, we're done. Okay, guys, you know, I'm going to go take a shower. You guys, you know, whatever, behave. So I'm really in there and I'm about to get in and I hear a ruckus coming from my kitchen and I come out and, you know, clad in a towel and I just see my two kids in front of the refrigerator. With the door open, my daughter is holding a can of whipped cream in her hand, and my son has whipped cream all over his face. They're reenacting the scene where Chunk gets all depressed and goes, sprays the whipped cream in his mouth.
Okay.
So, and I literally just look at them and I just said, what the fuck? I wasn't sure. I wasn't like trying to censor myself. I'm like,
yeah.
What the fuck are you guys doing?
Let it fly.
I tell you though, now I still have the movie running.
So it's made an impact. It left an impression. Yes. Clearly,
I'm getting ideas for one of our songs here because I don't know what the playout song is going to be yet. So I'm gonna And I'll figure that out. I don't know what song could be playing under us at this moment when you listeners finally hear it. But yeah, I think it, I mean, it's like anything too, like, you know, Indiana Jones, you know, Raiders of the Lost Ark, and that stuff. I mean, outside of Star Wars, I mean.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know what kind of stuff that's old, let's say, quote unquote, that kids that we were, you know, their age at the time are going to be into. I don't know enough people. I don't have kids myself and probably don't know enough people with kids to know that they really care or give a shit about this kind of, I mean, they have so many more choices.
Yeah.
So it's just maybe an unfair question to even put out there.
Yeah, unless they become like true movie fans, movie buff cinephiles. You know, I don't know how much they're really going to seek out some of these movies. I mean, there are like, you know, I tell them all the time, like, oh, I can't wait to watch this for you. Watch this. You know, there's movies like, you know, I still haven't let them watch yet because, you know, sometimes you get a little uncomfortable as a dad watching it. Like, it's like, I remember going to see Deadpool in the theater. And my daughter was begging me to see that. And I said no. And I went to see it. And I'm like, oh, my God. I finally relented like a year, maybe later, when I was on video. And I fast-forwarded through the calendar girl scene, if you will. But, yeah, watching these movies. Like, I've watched Hangover with my daughter now. I mean, stuff like that.
Yeah.
My son, it's
well,
like.
I mean, there's always, like, a question of content, I guess. I wonder, like, would they even think it's any good?
No, that's true, too.
I mean, I was really young when I saw this, and there's stuff that is inappropriate, but, I mean, I don't know what Ray getting a ghost beej is when I'm 5-6 years old, so it's the type of thing that even though, you know, you don't necessarily want a kid exposed to, if they don't know what's going on, then it's like, is it even that big a deal? But, I mean, even the humor that I didn't really get, I still liked the movie for what it was because there was enough going on outside of that, you know, that it just, it's a movie that just pops to me, you know what I mean? Like, pop, and it plays me nation.
it's iconic, too.
It's got a lot of action. It, you know, it's got a, it moves at a quick pace. It's, I mean, under 2 hours, which most movies aren't today.
No.
You know, cool visuals, cool effects, you know, there's action. It's just checks a lot of boxes, I think, for a kid. And I don't know. I always feel weird about parents like trying to force their own dumb interests on their kids.
Yes.
It's just sort of, this is one that I don't know. It's, feels like sort of a weird, litmus test almost.
I'm still trying to get them to watch. I think, I don't know if they've seen E.T. or not. I can't remember that. But like, it's like, you know, they want to go to, you know, we might do a big trip to Universal Studios next year in Florida. And it's like, you guys have got to watch this before you go on the ride, at least. Come on, you got to watch the E.T.
Yeah, have some kind of context.
Yeah, probably. I mean, but.
Good idea.
Just, these are iconic from like, you know, I was literally my son's age now when I saw this movie. And it's like, you know, I really, you know, I don't know. It's just, today, there's just, movies are so, you know, back then, you were able to go to the movies and watch movies over and over and over because we didn't have, you know, VHSs were just coming out then. There was no Blu-rays. There was no on-demand. There was no, you know, iTunes or whatever. So you saw it on, if you didn't see it on TV, you know, or cable, you know, you didn't see it, you know?
Yeah.
And, you know, I remember going to the movie theater. I think I saw Ghostbusters twice in the theater. But, I mean, like, E.T., I rode my bike, like, 4 times to go see that. I remember that same summer that came out. I think Rocky III came out. I remember going to see, I think, E.T. 4 times, Rocky III 3 times. And the people at the movie theater, like, starting to get to know me. I was there so much.
Wow. Yeah. Well, and plus, I mean, Ghostbusters would have been considered a big budget blockbuster movie for 1984.
Yeah.
And I mean that the definition and just the measuring stick for that has changed so much in the intervening over, you know, 35 years. This was made on, you know, less than $100 million, certainly. Mm-hmm. And today you hear about, well, what's the budget? Oh, $500 million. And you just sort of, you know, shrug. And it's just so typical now that, I mean, it's just, I don't know. The economics have changed so much. And I think that the expectations have changed accordingly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's definitely, it's an iconic movie. I mean, definitely something that people should seek out if they're going to continue the mythology with Jason Reitman's entry, which I think is supposed to come late next year, I think, from what
I'm... it's kind of what I'm hearing. Mm-hmm. One to watch.
Yeah. Well, I want to say thank you, Tim, for joining me for this movie tonight. I really appreciate it. And it was a good time. Just want to give a couple of plugs to the Place to Be Nation family of entertainment options here. Don't forget, we have two feeds. We have the Place to Be Nation wrestling feed, which you have a show on, as we talked about earlier, talking WCW. You guys have covered Daddy Arn, so to speak, Ric Flair.
That's right.
Dusty Rhodes, you got any teases for future episodes there? That you can.
Let's just say that the fourth outing of Talking WCW, which we have not actually scheduled yet, mm-hmm. but will be happening sometime in the month of April, we will be getting Steinerized.
Ah, very good. Looking forward to that one. So over there on the wrestling feed, we got great shows. We got Place to Be Podcast, the show that started all with Scott and Justin. We have the main event, which I was on the WrestleMania preview episode of, and I will not be on the post-WrestleMania show, but I will be on the next episode. Scott and I have this deal in agreeing to be my co-host on Urine Pop. You know, he has me on Great Debate, has a version of Great Debate on Main Event, where I actually bring wrestling questions to him, Nate, and Steve. So look for that. Uh-huh. Look for that coming in the weeks to come. Lots of other great shows are on the wrestling feed, reaction shows and the like. And then all over here on the Pop feed, where you and I reside, we have lots of fun shows. All of your shows we've mentioned, Talking Pop, Marvel Age Podcast. We have Binge Please, the Manager Todd Weber Show. We have the Glenn Butler Hour Podcast Spectacular. We have my shows, which are The Great Debate, which a new one might be up by the time this goes up, or should be coming soon with some first-time guests on Great Debate. Looking Forward, Looking Back has a big summer movie preview coming up, and Year and Pop will be back in probably late May, around Memorial Day. 1975 will be hitting. That to myself, Mr. Criscolo, Jad, J.R. Cimino D'Amato, and the Doctor, Dr. G, George Ribolino. So, and also, you know, you got all the Jenny shows, you got Geek and Sassy, check out the Sassies that just went up, Freak Out Driving, which I was just on, we did the 2004 version of Dawn of the Dead, which I quite enjoy that movie, and it's kind of gory, which Jenny quite loved that part of it.
So
check out everything, and also visit placemination.com. Content is ramping up. There's a new guy over there running things, and I hear he's got some plans for the site. So hopefully, there'll be a lot of fun stuff. And tournaments, more tournaments coming. Hope everybody enjoyed the Candy Tournament. If this is up after, thank you for voting. If it's up before, let's hopefully your candy wins. You know, we're down to the...
Hopefully it was Reese's.
Yes.
As Todd Weber would say.
At the time of recording, we are entering the fourth round, which is the Sweet 16, pun intended. So get your votes in if there's still time.
Right.
So once again, Tim, thank you very much for joining us tonight here in the Laughing Theater.
Andy, it's been a joy. Thank you for having me on. Thank you for indulging me, letting me talk about what is maybe still my sentimental favorite movie of all time.
Awesome, awesome. I'm glad I could share in your enthusiasm for this movie. Great. So for Mr. Tim Capel, I am Andy Atherton, and now the theater is closed. We'll see you on the next showing. Take care, everybody.
Promotional consideration paid for by the following. Place to Be Nation, JT Rosero and Chad Campbell here. We want to let you know that we have over 24 podcasts available on iTunes, Stitcher, Google Play, and PlaceToBeNation.com. We now offer them to you on two great feeds. On the Place to Be Nation Wrestling feed, we dive into topics running the gamut from today's WWE to the glory days of yesteryear and the ins and outs of the territory days. In addition to our full-length shows, we also deliver to you special pod blasts on topics old and new.
The Place to Be Nation Pop feed is a veritable treasure trove of great content, offering tremendous shows covering the land of movies, television, life, comics, and sports, brought to you by the most knowledgeable and insightful folks in the podcast world.
You can find all of these current shows, plus archives of our previous podcasts over the past 8 years as well, by subscribing to our feeds on iTunes. And while there, be sure to rate and leave feedback as well. All of these shows, plus others, available at PlaceToBeNation.com, where we cover pro wrestling, sports, movies, comics, plus in-depth stretch projects and more. Be sure to support our site by using www.PlaceToBeNation.com/Amazon while doing your online shopping. And be sure to join us at our forum at Bigelow34.proboards.com. For all sorts of wrestling, sports, and pop culture discussion each and every day, where you can make your voice heard. We also want to thank our friends at Boneheads Wing Bar, ProWrestlingOnly.com, and TheHistoryOfWrestling.com. Be sure to follow us on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and Tumblr as well. PlaceToBeNation.com, the only place to be in your pop culture world.
Chocolate? Fucking chocolate?
Oh, God.